I've never liked acting. I do it for to get the money to go and travel and go live 2 years in Spain, in Colombia. I've just been in Tibet. After every picture I made, I disappear. I have a long career of shame, the stuff I'm incredibly ashamed of. It came from because I just went for the buck, you know, the first thing that was available, never thinking to plan a career.
For actress Susan Tyrrell, self-reflection would often overlap with self-criticism. On one hand, she had vehemently described acting as a means to an end, yearning instead to disappear forever and spend her life traveling the world to put her career behind her. This is the same woman who once said, "I'm gonna get my tubes tied next week to ensure no actors come out of me."
Hi. How you been keeping?
Terrible.
And yet, she seemed proud of her achievements, from an Oscar nomination for her performance as a melancholy barfly in John Huston's introspective 1972 drama, Fat City.
That's a lie. Don't tell me what to do. I don't care who hears me. I know I'm making a nuisance of myself. All those goddamn Mexicans sitting there. They don't know who their real friends are. I hang with them.
To her favorite role as the campy Queen of the Sixth Dimension in Richard Elfman's absurdist 1980 musical, Forbidden Zone.
You're really out to lunch! Look at this world you've cooked up! And you expect to take over another universe? Ah, you dumb f***!
And she seemed right at home in the world of cult filmmaker John Waters when she played the shotgun-toting matriarch of a hillbilly family in Crybaby.
Goddamn gophers digging up my front yard! What are you teenagers waiting for? Turkey Point is open for business! Let's celebrate!
She left a big impression on John Waters, which is saying something.
Susan Tyrrell was the scariest woman I ever met. She was the most original, too. She put the C word in character actress. I remember the first night she came to Baltimore when we were making Crybaby, and every person that she was introduced to, she'd say, "Hi, I'm Susu, and I have the pussy of a 10-year-old, and I'm going to mail it to you in a box."
In both her life and career, Susu, as she preferred to be called, was an out-and-out rebel. In her later years, after plenty of cigarettes, cocktails, and a wide variety of mind-altering drugs, her acting roles were relegated to, quote, misfits, hags, and nut jobs, as Chris Garcia of the Statesman News Network put it. Truth be told, it was not unusual for her to play boozy prostitutes, or just good old-fashioned crazy assholes.
I got property here, and I ain't letting no government goddamn asshole drag me out of here so you can pull your goddamn condemnation on my land.
Other actresses might have shied away from this brand of unapologetic grotesquerie, but as Susan once said, I find beauty in the grotesque. So let's take a look at Susan Tyrrell's beautiful, rotten life. Susan was born in San Francisco as Susan Gillian Kramer near the tail end of World War II in 1945. Later in life, she would adopt her mother's maiden name, Tyrrell, reportedly for showbiz reasons. Her mother, Gillian Tyrrell, was part of the British diplomatic corps in China and in the Philippines in the 30s and 40s, and had lost 5 brothers in the Royal Air Force during World War II. Susan's father, John Belding Kramer, was a talent agent whose clients included Oscar-winning actress Loretta Young and beloved Disney character actor Ed Wynn. Arguably best known for playing Mary Poppins' laughter-infected friend, Uncle Albert, who has a tea party on the ceiling in Mary Poppins.
I love to laugh!
At some point during her adolescence, Susan's family uprooted and moved to Connecticut, where she did theater in high school.
But it went very fast from that high school production. There was an agent there, bim bam boom. I went to New York. My dad died right then, and I kind of did it to show him, or did it for him.
Around this time she was in New York, she had a mental breakdown and spent a brief visit at Harlem Mental Hospital. Afterwards, she dove headfirst into the theater world of New York City, where she got her first onstage role in 1963 as Ginger opposite Art Carney in a summer stock production of the comedy Time Out for Ginger. Susan's adventures in New York during the 1960s consisted of more theater, a couple television roles, and knocking around with artist Andy Warhol, who, when describing the best party he had ever attended, cited one thrown by Susu, in which she allegedly spiked the punch with LSD and stayed up cooking for everybody for 3 days straight. Susu has denied this. Then in 1971, Susan appeared in her first feature film, a Gregory Peck Western called Shootout, as a naive, kind-hearted prostitute in a brothel.
This here is Bobby J.
Bobby J. That's such a divine name, I just couldn't say no to a drink. They call me Alma.
Well, now, Alma, how old are you?
20.
Well, now you still got a couple of good years left.
It's easy to feel sympathy for Alma, especially the way Susan plays her. With any other actress, this might have been a standard damsel-in-distress kind of character, but there's just something about Susan's portrayal that adds another level, especially her voice. There's this tinge of innocence and sadness, like she's lived far too much for being 20 years old, and this work is all she knows.
I says to him, I says, do anything you want to set, and please don't touch my poor eye. Well, that was it. Red flag to the bull.
Did he smack you?
Yeah, right in the eye. I'm so dumb. I should have known. They just gotta do whatever it is a girl says they can't.
That same year, Susan was heavily featured in an episode of Bonanza entitled Fallen Woman as another sympathetic, down-and-out character. This time, she played an alcoholic mother pushed by Hoss to reform herself and get clean for her son.
I can give you a drink?
Ma'am, I think you've had enough.
Yes. No. You're right. You're absolutely right. Right. Besides, there's not enough left. Thank you. I don't mind if I do.
Around this time, at age 26, Susan found herself auditioning for legendary filmmaker John Huston for a major role in his new film, Fat City. She aced the audition and was cast as Oma, delivering what one reviewer for the New York Times described as, quote, one of the first believable drunks I've ever seen on screen.
He's so goddamn sour. I don't see why I can't have a little fun. I believe that everybody has a right to live his own life. So screw everybody.
The film also starred Stacy Keach as a down-and-out former boxer who befriends Oma, who seems to be the perfect listener as he waxes poetic about his better days. In one of the film's best scenes, Stacy and Susan's characters put back drinks in a dive bar, bearing their souls to one another.
I'm not ashamed to say it. I've never been ashamed of the act of love. I believe it's a part of life.
Some of it is sweet, but most of it is uncomfortable and sad. As the drinks keep coming, what follows is a roller coaster of miscommunication, mood swings, outbursts, self-hatred, and ultimately, professed love.
You're the only son of a bitch worth a shit in this place.
I appreciate that.
In other words, a drunken couple that might catch your eye in a bar and make you think, oh boy, that's not gonna end well. Not surprisingly, in the film, it doesn't.
If you don't want my company, just say so, I'll let you alone.
Where are you going?
Take a walk around the block.
Can I go with you?
No. Nope.
You're gonna go out for a drink and you're gonna leave me here?
I'm fighting in a week. You think I take a drink?
Billy, wait a minute. Let me get my shoe. Billy, wait, please!
The ladies nominated for the best performance by an actress in a supporting role are...
Thanks to her performance as Oma, in 1973, Susan attended the 45th Academy Awards as an Oscar nominee. She ultimately lost to...
Eileen Heckard in Butterflies Are Free.
Although this was clearly a milestone in her career, Susan would leave Hollywood shortly after the ceremony and spend 2 years living in Morocco. Was she overwhelmed by success? Was she sour about losing an Oscar? Or did something awful happen to her, something that drove her away? Nobody knew. At least, not yet. Real quick, I just want to take a minute and thank you for listening. I hope you're enjoying hearing about Susan's life as much as I enjoyed researching her. I loved just getting lost in her story, diving down a rabbit hole of interviews, Wikipedia articles, movies and TV shows I never would have watched. And it's like a treasure hunt, really, and it's always exciting. If you guys like what you hear, please share this episode, tell your friends, and help spread the word. Susan had some difficulty getting work when she ultimately returned to Hollywood. As she put it in a 1983 interview for Details magazine, quote, "It was hell. I couldn't even get a job as a bag lady. I went up for bag lady parts and they'd say, 'You're too beautiful now. We thought you were a bag lady from Fat City.' Then I'd go up for beautiful parts and they'd say, 'You're not beautiful enough.' An actor has to act, man. Lilies that fester smell fouler than weeds. You get sick, you die inside, and I'm not gonna be anybody's ass." Those seem like strong words for someone who, quote, never liked acting. In any case, she seemed like she didn't fit neatly into a category. Frustrating for her, but it did make for some interesting roles. In the 1974 Western Zandy's Bride, she played an old flame of Gene Hackman, jealous of his mail-order wife.
I was telling, Hannah here how good your place is looking. Yeah. I always did say what it needed was a woman's hand.
She reunited with Fat City co-star Stacy Keach in The Killer Inside Me as Joyce, an aging prostitute with a thick southern drawl who schemes to blackmail her boyfriend's father for money so she and Stacy Keach's character can run away together.
You play my kind of pool, Lou. Dirty.
You're crazy.
Yeah, I know. I got this kid I've been seeing. Real dumb. But his daddy's real rich. And if his daddy thought I was gonna marry the little son of a bitch, he'd cough up with anything I wanted.
You wouldn't do a thing like that, would you?
Oh, wouldn't I?
And she reunited with Andy Warhol to work on a film he produced in 1977, Bad. Okay, so the plot involves a female landlord who runs an underground network of female assassins. It's a world full of bizarre, evil characters making awful decisions with little to no remorse, and includes one graphic scene in which an infant is lifted out of his crib and unceremoniously tossed out the window of a tall building, hitting the ground and splattering blood all over a woman's face as she screams in horror. Now, you might have expected Susan to have joined in on this experimental depravity, but she actually played pretty much the only innocent person in the film, Mary, who struggles dealing with all the horrible people in her life as she's raising a baby on her own.
It's all right for a man to do those things, those phone calls and those mean people. But a woman shouldn't be that way.
What way?
Hard and mean.
From what you now know of this movie, does it sound like it's science fiction to you? The reason I ask is because in 1978, the same year Star Wars swept the Science Fiction Film Awards, now known as the Saturn Awards, Susan won for Best Supporting Actress for Bad. Technically, the award covers fantasy and horror too, so I guess it applies. She gladly accepted her award from Melinda Dillon of Close Encounters of the Third Kind and a guy in a Darth Vader suit.
This is real swell. I never knew being so bad could feel so good. This is my first award for anything ever. It seems fitting that it should be in science fiction and horror. I hope I give you a lot more reasons to give me a lot more of these. Thanks.
Now's a good time to bring up a strength of Susan's that you might have noticed. Her voice. There was always a little bit of raspiness to it, but there were two levels. When Ralph Bakshi wrote and directed one of his first animated features, Wizards, in 1977, Susan's soft-spoken narration perfectly set up the story and tone of the film.
The older fairy instantly knew that these were not ordinary twins, but magical wizards. The baby wizards were polarized like magnets.
6 years later, she narrated another Bakshi animated film, Fire and Ice, and the tone is notably different.
Long ago, at the end of the last great ice age, there arose in the north a powerful queen. Her name was Juliana, and her ambition was to extend her realm to all the regions of the known world.
These are the two voices of Susan Tyrrell, one soft, kind, and with an air of magic to it. The other, gravelly and evil, like you definitely don't want to mess with her. Kind of like when she went full-on evil in the Chipmunk Adventure as the main antagonist, Claudia Furstein, a diamond smuggler who uses Alvin and the Chipmunks as unwitting mules.
2 days and I haven't heard from anybody! Those incompetent fools! Where could they be? I'll find them if it's the last thing I do! And when I get my hands on those...
This polarity in her voice worked perfectly in arguably one of Susan's best roles in the horror film Butcher, Baker, Nightmare Maker. Now stay with me here, because I know that title sounds like this is maybe just a forgettable B-movie, but man, I am telling you, it is worth watching. Susan played Cheryl Roberts, who takes custody of her 3-year-old nephew, Billy, when his parents are unexpectedly killed in a car accident. The movie jumps forward in time when Billy's a senior in high school, and it's clear that Cheryl has an uncomfortable, Oedipus-esque relationship with him. Like when she cringes at Billy's mention of his new girlfriend, Julie.
Billy's got a girlfriend. Billy, you don't do that. That's disgusting.
I am going to be your date tomorrow night.
Sorry.
Whatever makes you happy.
You make me happy.
The film kicks into high gear when she throws herself at a TV repairman who promptly rejects her, hits her, inciting her to brutally stab him to death. From there, things start getting crazier and fast. Between the police investigating the suspiciousness of the crime, which Cheryl describes as an attempted rape, and Billy still planning to go away to college, Cheryl begins to slowly deteriorate.
Not until I said what I came to say.
You can talk to your blue in the face.
I saw you the other night. I know what you do.
She chops her hair off, looking like a feral animal, hunched over and wandering around the house, muttering to herself, looking like she hasn't bathed in a week. She routinely drugs glasses of milk, forcing Billy to drink them, keeping him sick and in the attic, which she's made up to look like his childhood bedroom.
Drink it! Drink it, I spoke to Chuck about you.
She begins to be more overtly sexual with him, kissing and licking him when he's barely conscious. I mean, it's an absolutely over-the-top, wretched character, but it's a lot of fun to watch.
I'm your girlfriend. Honey!
And of course, in typical good horror movie fashion, it ends with a lot of blood and chaos. Billy stabs her in the chest, she kisses him passionately, then collapses. Susan was convinced for years that this movie was awful. She thought the script was stupid and the whole thing was a joke. Luckily, for the Blu-ray release of the film in 2014, there's a special feature in which Susan reluctantly watches the film for the very first time.
So we watch as much as I can take. Okay, the boys are going to put it on now. I'm going to go get a stiff hit of tequila.
About halfway through, she actually starts changing her tune.
Brilliant! That's a great scene. I love that scene we just saw. I'd like to have that over and over and over. It's really good.
Susan was a private person for the most part and was never public about her love life. But one of the few relationships she talked about was with Hervé Villechaize, the famous dwarf who rose to prominence for playing Tattoo on Fantasy Island, and villainous henchman Knick-Knack in the Bond film The Man with the Golden Gun. They met doing a play in the 70s and lived together in a house in Laurel Canyon for close to 2 years. To hear Susan describe this period of her life, they had a lot of fun together.
Those were the acid years and days and moments and MDA.
Oh boy.
Oh yes. Heaven. Just fantasy land.
The relationship may have gone separate ways, but they did end up performing together on screen in Susan's favorite project she had ever worked on, Forbidden Zone. The film was meant as sort of a showcase of the experimental live performances of surrealist band The Mystic Knights of the Oingo Boingo, a group originally founded by Richard Elfman. It then transitioned into a straight rock band, Oingo Boingo, when Richard's brother, composer Danny Elfman, took over. Forbidden Zone is many things. It's a musical, it's a comedy, it's offensive, nonsensical, but what you can't say is it's not original. In short, right up Susan's alley. With a scene-chewing dramatic flair, she played Queen Doris of the Sixth Dimension alongside King Fausto, played by Hervé.
Life was so beautiful. Oh, why does it feel so good to be so bad? You were the only decent thing in my life. Smile at me one last time.
She loved the material, but also the closeness she felt with the cast and crew.
Because we all did everything. Hervé painted sets. He got there at 5 a.m. in his little overalls and painted his heart out. We just did it together. It was just like the greatest feeling of
togetherness,
camaraderie. Like, it didn't come close to Orson Welles, but it did in its sense of repertory actors. And great, great, great.
As we get into the 80s, Susan's roles began to diminish, both in quantity and screen time. By her own admission, she had reinvented herself physically. She cut her hair really short, dyed it blonde, and lost weight to the point where she was rail thin. It was a look that worked well when playing an eccentric lesbian landlord in the sexploitation action film Angel.
This psycho killer shows up, I'm gonna blow his f***ing head off.
Or a murderous journalist taking revenge on Vincent Price in From a Whisper to a Scream.
So you came here to...
I came here to meet the man who raised Catherine White. And to say thank you, in my own special way.
By stabbing him in the neck with a switchblade. One major highlight of hers was the Italian film Tales of Ordinary Madness. The film focuses on a poet and lecturer who indulges in a binge of hedonistic depravity. In an 11-minute sequence with almost no dialogue, he eyes Susan at a bus stop. The two flirt back and forth as he follows her home, knocks on her door, and what follows is by far the most sexually graphic scene that Susan had ever done.
Quiet, honey. Quiet.
Afterwards, it's clear that Susan's character saw the entire encounter as a fulfilled rape fantasy.
I like being raped. When I got off the bus, I thought you'd lose your nerve. Most men are cowards in the broad daylight.
Teaser.
When talking about the film in a 1983 interview, she said, quote, "I don't talk in this movie very much, which can be better. I hate talking. That's why I hate theater, these plays with monologues. Keep it down to the bone. Pass the information on, but don't break their balls with emotions. When you play a... you'd better have good writing to back you up. When you talk on and on about your goddamn problems, I can't stand it as an actress. I hate it as an audience." Around the late 1980s, Susan began writing a one-woman musical show titled My Rotten Life, a Bitter Operetta. The plot revolved around an aging actress stuck in limbo after her suicide, reflecting on the ups and downs of her life. Part comedy, part drama, it kind of comes off as autobiographical. But Susan maintained it was not about her, but it was rather stream of consciousness interpretations of her experiences as an actress.
Oh, God, I sucked. I really sucked. But I should have sucked a little harder.
It's difficult to discern how much truth is in the show, rather how much of Susan's life is similar with her character. After all, there aren't many real-life experiences of hers that we know of that we can compare, except for one.
It all began and ended with a director. Very famous director. He was a grandfather to me. But in Hollywood, grandfathers rape you. We all know this now. He had a thing for women and poodles. Actually, just poodles.
Following Susan's successful audition for Fat City back in 1971, director John Huston invited her on a road trip across the coast of Northern California, in which he was meeting up with some fellow millionaires to trade pieces of pre-Columbian art. Her agent at the time objected to the invitation, warning her not to go, but she jumped at the chance. In a 2000 interview for LA Weekly, Susan recounted, quote, "I was totally thrilled. The great John Huston, this grandfather figure. I'd just lost my dad, I hated my mother, and now here's another parent figure to cuddle me. The last thing in the world I'm thinking about is sex." After a few days with John and several drinking binges, she found herself in the bathroom of an extravagant beach house at 3 in the morning, sitting on the toilet and physically shaking as Huston knocked on the door and said, "All right, dear. Are you ready? Time to go to bed." From Susan's statements, what followed was a horrifying and demeaning experience, one that she didn't feel comfortable talking about for years or reporting to the police, stating that she felt if she went to court, she'd lose. In interviews, she would sometimes joke about it, stating that, quote, "I'd rather f*** John Huston any day than some lame director." But when talk show host Joan Quinn innocently and awkwardly brings up Fat City to Susan in a 1992 interview, it's clear that this event had a profound effect on her.
When you were nominated, you were for an Academy Award, you were so young, and we're all young one time. But anyway, do you attribute that to John Huston's direction? Did he pull something out of you that wasn't there or that you didn't know existed?
You're asking, this is a touchy subject, you know.
No, I don't know. I hear it's a touchy subject.
You know, it was in spite of him. I was acting in spite of him. It was another thing I'll show you.
Was it difficult?
Yes, it was very hard. He's famous for being a real prick to women. It's in all the books. It's nothing new. It's just it was new to me, and I loved him very much. He was a grandfather to me.
So you did try to bring yourself to the position of really giving everything you had because of the respect you had for him, or because you
I had
were...
no respect for him. I just said don't. It's survival. It was absolute survival, and I knew I just took a hold of it, and my very life, I acted for my life to keep him away from me and just to be the best I could. Against all odds.
I didn't realize the John Huston story. I thought maybe you had had an affair with him.
No.
And that you'd run away with
him.
This
is the first time I've ever spoken about it.
Well, that's why I didn't know.
Let's put it this way. Don't ever call it an affair.
Okay, well, that's what I wanted to know.
In my show, she says, he was a grandfather to me. But in Hollywood, grandfathers rape you. We all know this now.
Yeah, so that's what led me to think maybe I've missed
the whole point.
It's closer
to that.
And then in this interview with Skippy Lowe, who may sound familiar as he was Martin Short's inspiration for his bombastic talk show host character, Jiminy Glick, Skippy somewhat crassly continues to bring up John Huston.
But Fat City, come on, Fat City, John Huston. You were nominated for this great movie, and you and John Huston had something to do. What happened? There was something there.
Yes. What are you getting at, Skippy?
I'm getting out. Is that why Susan Tyrrell is a little bitter of Hollywood, or
very?
Because of that reason?
Because of something that personally that happened between John and myself. But I mean, as I say, bitterness is aging, and it is not pretty. And there's nothing in it. It just eats you up. So obviously, I'm not.
You're not
that bitter. I left. I went to Morocco for 2 years after the Academy Awards.
Houston, I want to get back. John Houston.
I bet you do.
I just went because he's a great director.
He was a cruel man.
Was he really?
Women like poodles. And in my show, I have her, she's dead with her dog.
Right.
And in my show, I have him running away with the dog instead of hurting me. Uh-huh. See, I have him doing it to the dog because he treated women like dogs. He was a very cruel, and he was, you know, a wonderful storyteller. And he did love me. I think he did.
This whole story gives a glimpse of Susan's feelings about acting. She said, quote, "I still hate him because what he took from me was huge. I totally believed in that world. I wanted to be an actress, and after that, it was all over. I never wanted to act again. He stole something sacred from me. He's the seed for all my behavior, and also the guilt, because I felt huge guilt that I didn't run out of there, titanic guilt for laying down with him. But that's how stupid I was, how naive, and I never got over it." Now imagine for a moment that something traumatic like this happened to you. Maybe you don't have to imagine, maybe it did, or maybe something much worse. Now imagine that this moment is tied closely with a high point in your life, polluting it forever. Because of her Oscar nomination, Susan was doomed to be asked constantly about Fat City, with people oblivious that it was permanently fused with a painful memory. I didn't know this, but apparently when you're nominated for an Oscar, you may not get the Oscar, but you do at least get a commemorative plaque for your nomination. Susan got one, and after her death, it was found jammed into the back of a kitchen cupboard in a Venice, California apartment. It reads, "Certificate of Nomination for Award. Be it known that Susan Tyrrell was nominated for an Academy Award of Merit for Outstanding Achievement, Best Supporting Actress in Fat City." Then underneath, in permanent black marker, Susan made an addendum, a skull and crossbones, followed by the words, "My Rotten Life." I guess, to her, the plaque just didn't look right without it. But Susan carried on, and her later career had its fun highlights. She was good friends with Paul Rubens, who asked her to play Midge Montana, a tiny woman who lives in Kris Kristofferson's pocket in Big Top Pee Wee.
"Midge, this is Pee Wee Herman. He runs this place. He's been helping us out."
No big deal. I used to know someone named Midge when I was little. Small world.
It's all right, kid, relax. It's nice to meet you.
Likewise, Midge.
There was, of course, her unhinged performance as Ramona Ricketts in John Waters' Crybaby.
"Now, baddest baby of them all, the man you came here for, the big boo-hoo, the terrible teardrop, oh, ladies and gentlemen, my grandson Crybaby!"
Then in 2000, Susan was hit with another blow after she was diagnosed with essential thrombocytosis, a rare blood disease, and both of her legs had to be amputated below the knee. In a 2012 article for Austin 360, she was quoted as saying, "I kissed my legs goodbye way before they cut them off. I told them, I know what's going on, just cut them off quick. I always said that I was the perfect person to lose their legs. If anybody has to lose them, take mine." Afterwards, she took pleasure in drawing extravagant floral designs on her prosthetic legs, as if they were tattooed. After her surgery, people from Tyrrell's life, as well as fans, banded together to help with her medical bills when Crybaby co-star Johnny Depp hosted a benefit at the Viper Room in Los Angeles. Comedian Taylor Negrin, who had known Susu for over 20 years, emceed the event. Actress Chloe Webb auctioned off the pair of shoes Susu wore before her operation. And there were musical guests, like Megan Mullally of Will & Grace, and Jack Black and Kyle Gass as Tenacious D. All in all, the event was a success. Susan did continue to act, albeit sparingly. Her final role was in the 2012 indie drama Kid Thing, and it was just her voice. She played Esther, a woman crying out for help at the bottom of an abandoned well. An apathetic young girl with no moral compass discovers her, but hesitates to help her.
"Before it's too late, you're the only one who can help me. I'm tired. devil.
How do I know you're not the devil?
No, you're the devil.
No, you're the devil. You won't help me when I need help.
You're trying to bully me, mess with my head. For all I know, I'm probably going to pull you out of hell.
Listen here, little girls. Do as I say. I'm tired of asking nicely. Do as I say.
I don't have to do anything I don't want to.
Damn you, Eddie. Damn you.
After settling down in the city of Austin in 2008 to be closer to her niece, Susan spent her free time painting sexually explicit, boundary-pushing art and being helped around the house by a friend, artist Yvonne Lambert. Yvonne said of Susan, quote, "She's so caring, so giving. I think a lot of people see her as a very salty, sassy, saucy lady, and that's part of her. But the Susu I fell in love with is this beautiful, good-hearted, sweet lady." On June 16th, 2012, Susan Tyrrell passed away in her sleep at the age of 67. There were at least two memorial services in her name, one at the Silent Movie Theater in Los Angeles and one at the Alamo Draft House in Austin, titled Susan Tyrrell's Rotten Memorial. Yvonne Lambert performed music at the memorial, dressed in Susu's original lingerie costume from My Rotten Life, A Bitter Operetta. Other friends and co-workers of Susu came out of the woodwork with nothing but loving things to say, as well as plenty of fun stories. Fat City co-star Stacy Keach wrote, quote, "I loved her whiskey voice, always reeking of soul and sweetness. She sang the blues with every word she spoke, and the unique colors she brought to the behavior of the characters she played always embraced a vivid portrait of a highly sensual woman, sexy and vulnerable, not unlike the qualities of a battered Marilyn Monroe." There was also Forbidden Zone director Richard Elfman, who fondly remembered how she took the income she received from SAG residual payments and funneled them into the budget of Forbidden Zone to help it get made. Film historian Justin Humphreys recalls Susu doing a good deed that was never talked about.
There's a story that very few people know about Susu. She lived in a bad barrio in L.A., and upstairs from her lived a vicious gang girl named Nika. One day, Susu said she heard a terrible wailing in Nika's room and went up to investigate. There, Susu found Nika, dead from an overdose, and nearby was Nika's crying baby boy. Susu got the boy adopted by a loving mother who gave him a healthy upbringing. She saved that boy's life, and she didn't go looking for anyone to pin a medal on her for it. That's real character.
And director John Waters really summed her up in the best way possible, so I'm just gonna let him talk.
She was an anarchist, a sexual terrorist, and I use that in the best sense of the word, because underneath it, she used a hilarious woman. She was a hilarious woman underneath it, and she used humor as armor, as self-protection, and if necessary, as a weapon. She could be aggressive, she was easily hurt, she was sexy, she was funny, she was loyal, she was very quick to fall in love, and she was fearless, and above all, she was an amazing actress. She worked with all the nutcase directors. If there's a heaven, Susu's ripping that place up tonight, and even God is nervous. She was an amazing lady, and the lunatic fringe of show business, which I'm proud to be part of, mourns one of its greatest stars, Susan Tyrrell. Nobody was like her.
Susan used her sexuality and humor to the best of her ability and seemed to take pride in her raunchy persona. And as much as she says that she was turned off by acting with her experience with John Huston, I think it's fair to say that there were, at the very least, fleeting moments of joy in her career. She once described the last thing her mother said to her before she died. "Susu, your life is a celebration of everything that is cheap and tawdry. I've always liked that, and I've always tried to live up to it."
Now, thanks to the Lord, I've been set free. My lover is the trade winds that take me out to sea.